Good evening. I'm Sibongile Tshabalala. As Hannah introduced me, I'm from South Africa. I'm currently the National Chairperson of Treatment Action Campaign in South Africa. Just newly elected as the chairperson recently in August 2017. I will start with my story as a person who's living with HIV. How did I suffer because of not accessing treatment? I was diagnosed in the year 2000 on the 31st of October with HIV. And that time, I was very ill. I could even not be able to leave a bed. I was bedridden. I had deeper jaundice. I couldn't eat. I couldn't even drink water without throwing it back. So the situation was very bad. And everyone thought, now this is it, I'm gonna die. The problem at that particular time, it was that as much as they were trying in the country to fight opportunistic infections that are caused by HIV, but we had a problem of not accessible. We couldn't access ARVs in the country. Only the few who were able to access ARVs in the country, those who are affording to buy, or those who are rich. At that particular time, ARVs, a month treatment, it cost about 5,000 rands for just one month. And if you can't afford that, it means you won't access them. So I was one of those people who couldn't afford to buy the treatment. In my family, only my dad was working, and we are a family of five children, so he can't, and he wasn't earning that much. So he was unable to save my life. So I had to depend on whatever the health system is giving me. But at that particular time, I needed ARVs, but I couldn't access them because of the high prices that were there in the country. I had to wait for 6 years for me to access ARVs. While I was struggling, waiting for the ARVs, trying to get a way of living, I suffered TB, I suffered shingles twice, I suffered pneumonia, I suffered bronchitis. So in a year, I knew that I would be hospitalized once, twice, or thrice. So I was a victim of a hospital. Even if you enter the casual ward, they will ask you, Sibongile, what's wrong now? Because you are well known, you are always there, because you always feel sick. So it wasn't easy. However, I survived. But through those years, in 2005, I lost my husband because of AIDS-related diseases. I had to continue with my life because when I lost my husband, we had a son. He was 12 years old. He needed his parents. So I had to fight back. I felt like I can never, I was given an opportunity by God to be raised by both parents. My son doesn't have a father now. He can't afford to lose a mother. So I have to fight back. It wasn't easy to fight back because when you are sick, every day you pray to say, God, can you please save me? God, I'm not yet tired. Please give me another chance. Let me live for another day or two. Or let me see my son at least grow up. So those were the difficulties. And while I was fighting, I had to fight stigma and discrimination. Not by my family directly, but by my extended family, my cousins, my aunts, because they wanted to know what's wrong with me. And for me to tell them what's wrong, I could face more discrimination, because at that particular time, HIV in the country was treated as this dirty disease. And when we are infected with HIV, everyone will ask, where did she get it? It means she was sleeping around. It means she was not handling herself in the right manner. It means she has many boyfriends. They will give you all sorts of stories, and they will think badly about you, and you are a curse in the family because it means you didn't behave well as a person. So most of people died because of stigma and discrimination. Others were even stoned to death because they were disclosing their status. So situation was very bad. So for me to access treatment, as I've said earlier, I had to wait for almost 6 years. In that 6 years, as I've said, I struggled, but eventually in 2006, July, I started my treatment. My CD4 count was 168, and I was full-blown AIDS. It means I was very sick. So at that particular time, you are sick, but you don't even know which part of the body is painful, because almost everything is painful. Even sometimes you will be afraid to say, I'm sick today. When a person asks you, how are you feeling today? You will be like, I'm much better. Why do you know that you're suffering? Because you don't know where you will say it's painful today. Every day there are different places of your body where you don't feel well. So I had to start my ARVs. Because my CD4 count was below 200, I suffered side effects of the treatment. So I had to be hospitalized again for almost 2 months because I had mild stroke and other side effects. So when I was hospitalized, I was taken to a hospice. And at that particular time, when we are taken to a hospice, everybody will say, now it's a one-way ticket. She or he's not coming back. Fortunately enough, I took a return ticket. I came back. As I'm still standing here today. But most of people who started treatment very late, they didn't survive. So I only thank God for that. While I was fighting for my life, TAC was born in 1998 and December. It was the International Human Rights Day. So there was a guy in South Africa called Zaki Ahmad who is living with HIV because he's still alive. He is living with HIV. He's one of the freedom fighters in the country. He was fighting for our liberation in the country, but later on he found out that he's HIV positive. And other few friends, they were HIV positive, and he lost some of his friends along the way. So as much as he was able to afford treatment, but he looked back and said, we fought for liberation of the country. We fought for people to live a better health, a better life, but people are dying. So what's the use of me accessing a treatment while other South Africans, they cannot access treatment? So they started to launch TAC. The first fight of TAC, it was access to treatment. But because they had to start somewhere, they started to fight for a fluconazole. Fluconazole is it's a pill that help cryptococcal meningitis and thrush. So most of people were dying because when you're HIV positive, your immune system is compromised. Cryptococcal meningitis, it's easy for you to attack you. Thrush, which it causes you not to be able to eat. Sometimes it will have a throat thrush and then you will die from that. So they started the campaign of fluconazole. Fluconazole in the country, it's not like it was not there. It was there, but it was expensive. It was expensive, it was costing about 29 rands per kilo. And while in other countries like Thailand and India and other countries, it cost less than 2 rands. So what happened, TAC tried to engage Pfizer, which is a pharmaceutical company that was held in that paycheck, to say, we need this drug because most of people are suffering from meningitis and thrush. And can you please lower a price so that our government will be able to buy and supply to other to the public? And Pfizer promised to to lower the price, but they dragged their feet. So while they were busy dragging their feet, making profit, people were dying on the other side. So TAC decided to take Pfizer to court. And we won that case as TAC because most of people were dying. And we were fighting along one side with the government. The government wanted Pfizer to lower the price. We wanted Pfizer to lower the price, but Pfizer would not come into the party. So we fight together, and we won the fight. We had fluconazole in the country. At the time we were winning this case, it was still the president was still Nelson Mandela. And then soon after that, Mandela had to step down. And then there comes Thabo Mbeki. That was a challenge. There started the problem. Thabo Mbeki didn't believe that HIV causes AIDS. Thabo Mbeki didn't believe in ARVs. So he was a denialist. So why most of people were needing ARVs, Thabo Mbeki wouldn't come to the party, wouldn't listen to us. Instead, he called for more research on HIV, why HIV does cause AIDS, what could be the problem, and all those things. Yes, we believe in research, we want research, but at that particular time, we were losing most people. So there was no time for research, while in other countries, ARVs are there, people are living with ARVs and are treatable with HIV. So why should we start by doing the research in the country while there is something that it's out there that we can use, or this is something that is in the country but we cannot all access. So we all wanted him to engage, at least engage the pharmaceutical companies, they lower the price, the government be able to buy ARVs, but he wouldn't do that. So fortunate enough for him, because he had a minister who was stubborn as he is, Dr. Mando Tshabalala Msima. I always say this, she's a Tshabalala, but we are not in the same blood, from the same blood. We share the surname. That surname is very popular in South Africa. So, the minister, she was a doctor by profession, but she believed in beetroot and garlic, of which is not wrong. Vegetables are making our bodies to be healthy, but too much of everything, it's not okay. And at that particular time, you are HIV positive, your immune system is compromised, you are told to eat beetroot. How? You don't know. So I was one of those people who were forced to eat beetroot every day by my mom, because she was trying to support me. She would cook beetroot in the morning, lunch, and supper. She would even make me drink beetroot water. And every time I had to run to the toilet, because my stomach now is loose, I have diarrhea because of the beetroot. And she will make me eat garlic now and again. I will even smell garlic. Even my sweat will need to smell garlic. And I'll be like frustrated because these things, I don't want it anymore. But because they're trying to save my life and they're supporting me, she's supporting me, I have to take them. Which was not fair on us. Those two vegetables, they will not treat HIV, and they won't even make you feel strong. Instead, like beetroot, it will make you worse, because once you went to the toilet, you had diarrhea, you have to come back and drink a lot of water so that you'll be able to be more strong. So it wasn't fair. So while we were fighting for ARVs, we as TAC, we've noticed that most of women are giving babies to children with HIV. And along the way, they are losing their babies, of which is not fair. The constitution of the country, under chapter 2, section 11, it says everyone has a right to life. And section 27 of the constitution says everyone has a right to reproductive health right, and everyone has a right to quality healthcare service. And if government must make its must make measures that it protects and provides where it's necessary for people. So we use those codes of the constitution to take our government to court, because Thabo Mbeki was not coming into our heart. So we had to fight for AZT, which is a drug, a combination drug of zabudim and nevirapine, which it will protect a baby when you are, the woman is giving birth, that a woman will take, when she is on, she's in labor pains, she'll be able to take that drugs, that drug, and then it will save the baby. We won the fight in 2000 in court, and women were given that pill. But it was still difficult because only women who were pregnant were given that pill. Remember earlier on I talked about stigma and discrimination. So most of women were tested, only knew about their status when they are pregnant. So when you are pregnant, you go to the clinic, to the health facility, into an antenatal clinic, you are tested HIV positive, you don't know where to start your husband and disclose your status. Because once you disclose the status, as a woman, you'll be called all these names, you'll be asked, where did you get this disease? It means you're not faithful, it means you're sleeping around and all those things. So most of women, even though they were given that AZTP, but they couldn't use it because they are afraid to show their husband that I have this pill that I have to take when I'm in labor. And other women, because of false labor pains, a woman will take that pill before time. When she gets to labor, she can't take it again because it's in her system, it will resist. Other women, because she's in labor, she forgets everything, she won't take the pill. So children continue to be born with HIV. And those who were saved, those women who managed to take a pill, children were saved, but those women, we lost them. They passed on after giving birth or few years after that because they didn't have something that will treat them on their HIV statuses. So that was the problem. We've seen a high number of orphans in the country. We've seen more young children dying. So every day in the country, we're burying almost 1,700 people. That's a number. And funeral business was booming every corner. Every corner you go, you'll find a funeral home. So other people were making money, other people were dying. And the government was not even taking note of that. Even if he was told every day that people are dying, we need ARVs. So what we did as TAC, we had to collaborate with other organizations, which is MSF and Clinician Society AIDS Law Project. Clinician Society and MSF came into our party and they taught us a science of HIV. And that's where we know treatment literacy, and that's where we knew why we need ARVs and what our ARVs are going to do in our bodies. So when we fight back, at least we had something to fight on, information that we know why do we need ARVs. And AIDS Law Project, because they are lawyers, they came to our party and they taught us constitution of the country. So as much as you didn't go to a university or wherever, but as layperson as you are, you were able to combine the two, the science and the law. So we were able to explain ourselves as activists in the country to say why we need ARVs and why is it important that government should take measures to make ARVs available. So we had to take government again to court in the year 2002 for access to treatment campaign, where we wanted everyone in the country to have ARVs, who was eligible for ARVs. We won the case in the court, but Thabo Mbeki and Manto Tshabalala Msimang, they didn't acknowledge the court's ruling. They continued to drag their feet, and in 2004 we had to go back to court to say, as much as you ruled in favor of us, but we are still having this challenge. So in 2004, we won the case again, and the government was forced to roll out ARVs. However, ARVs were rolled out in the pilot size, which means few places where ARVs were accessible. Not everyone in the country will be able, or who's eligible for treatment, will be able to access that treatment. And because there were a lot more people who were living with HIV, we had long queues of people waiting for treatment. That is why I accessed my treatment after 2 years while we won the case. So what happened? you will be, you were supposed to have a CD4 count that is less than 200 for you to access ARVs. And at some point, people will go late into the facility or will access treatment late. They will die because of treatment side effects. So the situation was not still okay in the country. So TAC had to continue to educate communities and to encourage people to go to the facilities while it's still early, because others, they didn't test until they are very sick. So we encourage people to go and test. We encourage people to go to facilities and take treatment while it's still early. But sometimes, because of people long queues, you cannot access your medication. So that's how we fought the government and pharmaceutical companies in the country. However, we asked ourselves as TAC to say, are we still relevant? Because now we have ARVs in the country. Do we still have to continue with this work? We said yes, because there are still challenges in the healthcare system. We're still facing stockouts. We still want more new drugs, especially for HIV and other illnesses. If I can just make an example, when I started my medication, I started taking efavirenz, difluprednate, and lamivudine. Difluprednate is one of the drugs that was, it was okay because it made you survive, but it deformed most of people. So it will take fats from where they are and relocate it to other bodies of parts of your bodies. Like, you know, in South Africa, South African women, we like big figured women with big bums and all those things. But you find that a woman now, she no longer have bums, but she has big stomach or big breast, or sometimes a woman will be shaped like a man. So people were not happy. That drug will even remove fats from your face. So you look like that old man. I don't know who's like, I don't know how to describe it, but very bad. So we discovered that there is another drug which has fewer side effects than Stavudin. We had to fight for Tenofovir, which that drug is a little bit better than Stavudin. So we managed to access it through court, through going to the streets, through marching, through engaging pharmaceutical companies. So now the D40, it was phased out. Now we are taking, I'm sorry to say, Stavudin was phased out. Now we are taking D40, which is the drug that it has less side effects. So all I'm saying, as treatment action campaign, we continue to fight for access to medicine. One of the medicines that now we are busy fighting for is trastuzumab, which is a drug that treats cancer, especially breast cancer for women. Women who are tested HER2 positive. So it's needed in the country. What is happening, Roche, which is company based in UK, is that drug, UK and other countries, it's no longer under patent. But in South Africa, it's still under patent, which it costs about R500,000 for a woman to access a year treatment. So we're still facing a poverty in the country. Most of people are still not working, or they are earning much lesser than that. They can't afford to buy that treatment. So even if you are working, even if you are under a private sector where you have medical aid or you can be able to buy, because it's so expensive, most of medical aid, they are not buying that medication. I have an example of one woman which we've lost her last year, Tobeka Dagi. She was suffering from breast cancer. She was eligible to access trastuzumab. Her medical aid couldn't buy aid because they said the drug is too expensive. She tried to go to the public sector. The public sector said, we are very sorry, we don't have that drug because it's very expensive. So the government cannot be able to afford to buy. So even if government wants to buy it, the government will buy for how many people? Because there are a lot of women in South Africa who are living with breast cancer. So that is the challenge that we have. And we just recently found out that there are, we have 24 drug cancer drugs that are still unattended and that people from South Africa, they need. So we've launched a campaign with Cancer Alliance that talks about those drugs, why we are questioning to say why they are still unattended. And while we are busy fighting with Roche, we are also fighting our own government. We are also fighting our own government through DTI, because DTI is the one that makes these laws. So in South Africa, when you apply for a patent, they don't do their research. They just check the forms if you have filled every block in the form. Once you filled all the blocks, then you are granted a patent. So of which it's not right, because it's not on public interest. So we marched from 2009 up to last year, and then recently we just had a draft policy that at least it's on our favor as civil society. So in that draft policy, what is it's going to happen? If a company comes and wants to register a medication, the country needs to investigate or do its research to check whether this medication is not under, it's still under patent in other countries, and will check whether this drug is mostly needed by community in South Africa, and civil society will have to come and oppose if the drug is needed and it's more expensive, or the drug is under patent in other countries and they want to register it and they want to get a license, a patent license in the country. But we marched last week on the 24th of October to the DTI, welcoming the policy, the draft policy, as I'm saying, it's still a draft, it's not yet into implementation, and we want it to be implemented quicker, because we've been fighting, while we were fighting for this policy, pharmaceutical companies were trying to block us, not to continue. They even plot a six million plot with pharma, we called it pharma grid. So what they did, they were trying to buy our government not to continue with that policy. And they were trying to make the process go more slow. So we fought back as civil society, especially treatment action campaign, because we were the ones who were leading. We marched to the pharmaceutical companies, we marched to the DTI to say, we know what is happening, and we lobbied the Minister of Health. Actually, the minister, the current Minister of Health, he's the one who lobbied us, because he told us earlier to say, this is what is happening, this is what I've heard. And as treatment action campaign, we just jump and challenge the pharmaceutical companies. So what is happening now? We are still on that draft, and we are pushing for that draft to be taken to the parliament, because it's just passed by the cabinet. It needs to be taken to parliament. And we are pushing for the DTI to take it to the parliament so that we'll be able to fight the patent laws that are in the country. So there is a lot that we are doing in STAC, because my time, it's no longer, I have only less than 1 minute. there's a lot that we are doing. Anyone who would like to know more about us and our work, you can just go to our website, which is www.tac.org.za. There's a lot that you can see there. You will see our videos, you will see most of our work. We just, we have a broken, we have health strengthening system campaign that we are embarking on these days. So we are very active in the country. Yesterday we were in the news, day before yesterday we were in the news. You can just go in your website and check us there. That's where we are. Thank you very much.